Welcome everyone. So this video today is about a relatively advanced concept called dual feasible functions. And we recently relied upon it in a research project, in particular with Nicolas and Maxime. So we prepared this video together to share our understanding. It is meant for our master's students of ORCO, but of course any master, PhD, teacher or researcher in OR. Now, you need to know already about bin packing and integer programming models for bin packing. And you will get most of the video if you are familiar already with exponential formulations and column generation. So it is really meant for our students once you have done the class about column generation techniques. Okay, the goal is to start with the L2 lower bound for bin packing, the Martello and Tot lower bound, because it is a specific dual feasible function, and it will help us to understand the general framework of dual feasible functions. And once you get that, you see that you have a class of valid inequalities for any knapsack constraint. So it is a very general and powerful framework to improve mixed integer programming formulations. Okay, so let's go into it. Okay, let's start with bin packing to make sure we agree on the notations. We are given a set I of items, n of them, and each item has a size si. We are also given a set of bins, b, and each bin has a capacity w. You have an example of a dataset here with 5 items, a, b, c, d, e, and their corresponding sizes. The capacity has been set to 10. And the problem is to assign these items to a minimum number of bins so that the capacity of each bin, W, is satisfied. Each bin is not overloaded. A feasible solution is displayed here. It is using 4 bins. And in this example, we have put item A and E together on the same bin. That's okay since 1 plus 9 equals 10, which is less than W, less or equals than W. And the objective value of this feasible solution is 4 since it is using 4 bins. So let's recall now an integer programming model. And our model is using 2 sets of variables. Variable xij equals 1 whenever item I is assigned to bin j. And variable yj is set to 1 when bin j is used when at least one item has been assigned to bin j. These are important because we compute the number of bins as the sum of the yj, and we are minimizing this quantity. Each item I must be put on exactly one bin, and for each bin j, the capacity must be satisfied. So the left side here is the load of bin j. Now this is not enough, we also must channel the x and y variables. We must make sure that if xij is set to 1, then yj is set to 1. And the bin must be considered open or used as soon as an item is put on it. An easy way to do that is to add yj on the right side. And so that whenever the load is not null, yj must be set to 1. And reversely, if yj is put to 0, then the load should be null. No item can be put on the bin. Now, what you know already about this model is that a key feature is its linear relaxation, because it is used at each node of the branch and bound tree to prune the search space. So, we relax the integrality constraints so that the x and y variables can take fractional values. This is the key idea of the linear relaxation. And a feasible solution is given here as an example. You can, since so x variables can take fractional values, we can now split items. So in this case, item B, 0.4 of item B has been put on bin 2 here, and 0.6 of item B has been put on bin 3. And if you take these values, you can check that these 2 constraints are satisfied, and the fractional requirements as well. So that this is a feasible solution of the linear relaxation, and it gives us a lower bound for the optimal value. And the objective value here is 1 plus 1 plus 0.9, 2.9. That's a lower bound. Since we know we must have an integer number of bins, We know we need at least 3 beans. It is a lower bound. We also know we need at most 4 beans because we have a feasible solution of value 4. So the optimal value, Z star, is either 3 or 4. Now, of course, in this example, it's pretty obvious this solution is optimal, but it is only a toy example. If you are watching this video, you know that this question in general is a difficult one, is a hard one. Okay, so the linear relaxation is doing a simple reasoning by splitting items. This is also called the L1 lower bound. Just sum the sizes divided by the capacity and round the result to the nearest integer above and save the result. On this example, 29 divided by 10, 2.9, rounding the results gives you 3. But a much more clever lower bound has been designed. It is the L2 lower bound, the bound of Martello Entente. So we are now going into the key topic of this video. Now the idea for this bound is to actually change the size from S to S lambda using a parameter lambda. It is a transformation of the size of the items. The general expression for this transformation is this one, and I will explain it using also the example. Okay, to change the sizes, we consider three cases. Let's look at the first one. If the original size SI is bigger than W minus lambda, then the size is changed to W. It is increased to W. So if we set lambda to 2.5, any items bigger than 10 minus 2.5, which is 7.5, so the green items on the example, so any of these items will increase to W. Now the items in between lambda and W minus lambda, the pink items on the example, are left unchanged. And the remaining items, the ones that are smaller than lambda, the red one, are set to 0. Okay, now why do we do that? In fact, Martello and Todd tells us that if we now compute L1 over S lambda as opposed to S, we can have something bigger and it is a valid lower bound. So let's check the quantity first. If we do the sum of the new sizes, we have in this case 31, which is bigger than 29, and if we apply the L1 reasoning, we get a lower bound of 4. That is an improvement, and it is enough for our example to prove the optimality of this solution. Okay, but we need to say something more here, because we need to make sure this quantity is a valid lower bound for the original problem. And what we can show, in fact, is that any feasible solution for S is also feasible for S lambda. So we really want to understand that. And we will do the proof together. It's quite easy to see, actually. So if you consider any feasible solution of the original problem, the beans of any feasible solution are made of one of these five categories, configurations. Typically, in a feasible solution regarding the three categories of items, we can, for example, have a bean made only with small items. Any number of small, no medium, no large. It would look like this. A bean can also be made of medium items only, and it would look like this one. Or it could be made with a single large item. You can only put a single large item because if you check the conditions, a large item has a size bigger than half the capacity. So you can have at most one of them in a bin. Of course, you can do that as long as the capacity is satisfied. And you can also mix things together. You can put smalls with mediums or smalls with a single large, as long as the capacity is satisfied. So, the beans of a feasible solution belong to one of these configurations. What you cannot have, typically, is you cannot have a green with a pink. And if you check the condition, a large item has a size strictly bigger than W minus lambda, and a pink item, a medium one, has a size bigger than lambda. So when you sum the two together, you get something bigger than W, and that is not possible. So you can pause the video and check that the only 5 possible configurations for the beans are these ones. Now if you agree with that, just apply S-lambda. And for each bean, it would give you the following beans. This one would become empty. Red items are set to 0. This one would be left unchanged. This one would be filled entirely, and so on. But the key point here is that since each of these beans are initially feasible, well, they remain feasible after applying S-lambda. And if you agree with that, then you agree that any feasible solution for S is feasible for S-lambda. So pause the video and make sure you agree with that, and also that you understand that it means that computing L1 over S-lambda is indeed a valid lower bound because of this statement. All right. Now, it even goes further than that. Actually, because of that statement, this constraint is a valid inequality. And we took this constraint and we changed the S for S-lambda. Any feasible solution must satisfy this constraint, and because of that statement, it is also true for this constraint. And if you apply it to our example, it would be like this for bean J using the new sizes. And considering the values, the linear relaxation we gave as an example, it is actually violated on bean 2. And you can replace the values and check it is the case. So this valid inequality is actually a useful one. It is able to cut the linear relaxation and it might improve the lower bound that we get from the linear relaxation. Now, to conclude, the L2 bound is actually to take the best quantities over all possible lambdas. I don't go into details here, but you only have to consider a restricted set of values for lambda if you think about it. And this can be computed very efficiently. It is not the main point here, so I don't go into details. The main point is to understand the L2 lower bound and the fact that it gives a valid lower bound and a valid inequality. Okay, so this was the first board of our video. And we will now generalize these ideas to dual feasible functions. To see that, we need to recall the Gilmore and Gomori model for bean packing. In this model, we have a variable rho k for each possible pattern. So omega is a set of possible patterns, the set of all possible ways to fill a bean. So omega has an exponential size, there is an exponential number of such patterns. And we have a variable rho k for each of them, so rho k equals 1 if pattern k is used in the solution. We want to minimize the number of patterns because that will match the number of beans. And what we require is that each item occurs in the patterns that have been selected. So let's call omega of I, or for the example omega of A, the set of patterns that contains item A. This constraint states that we need a pattern that covers item I. You can check that. So this is our model. Now it's an integer programming model, and we can consider its linear relaxation. And just replace this constraint by rho k positive. We don't actually need rho k less than 1 because it is satisfied in any optimal solution. And the reason is that there is nothing here that requires rho k to be strictly greater than 1. If that was the case, we would have a better solution by setting back this rho k to 1. So any optimal solution will satisfy this constraint. We actually don't need to state it in the model. And this is the linear relaxation. Now it has an exponential number of variables. And you might already know that we can still solve efficiently the linear relaxation with a simplex algorithm with a technique called column generation. Basically, when the simplex requires a variable of negative reduced cost, we can generate it on the fly. We don't have to generate all the variables in advance. That would not work. But we can generate them on the fly, and the linear relaxation can be computed efficiently. So you only need to know that. Now, this is the primal, and we can state the dual. Since we have a constraint for each item in the primal, we have a variable for each item in the dual. Since we have a variable for each pattern in the primal, we have a constraint for each pattern in the dual. So you can check this is the dual formulation for this primal. What we need next is the concept of functions that keep feasibility. We have already seen that concept with the S lambda. We could call it f of s to see that it's a function. And we know that the key property of such a function we have seen before is to keep feasibility. In other words, if we have items that fit together in a bin, they still do when you apply f on each of them. So patterns remain feasible after applying f on each item or each object. We can generalize that as follows. Let's consider f from 0w to 0w satisfying this property, so that for any subset S of items, if they fit together in a bin, their images also fit together in a bin. This is the key property of these functions. Now let's go a step further and state this definition in 0,1. So we rescale everything in 0,1. It will make it easier to for the next of the course. So replace S here by S prime just by rescaling the size. So divide S by W. And basically this assumption becomes this one, and the property and the definition can be stated as follows. Starting from this definition, we finally go to the concept of dual feasible functions. I, in this definition, is not the set of items anymore, and the sizes have become real positive numbers. And the feasibility property is stated over these numbers in general. Now, if this is true, then f is said to be dual feasible. Note that in this definition, since I is not the set of items anymore, the definition does not refer to bin packing anymore. All right. So a natural question about it would be, why is it called dual feasible? And you can maybe guess that it refers to this dual. To see that, what we can do is just consider a dual feasible function f and the bin packing problem. And you can compute these numerical quantities and plug them into the alpha. So we refer to that as alpha tilde. What we can see is that it is actually a dual feasible solution for D. So let's see that together. First, let's consider subset of items such that the sum of their rescaled size is less than 1. And since F is dual feasible and we have this assumption, then we also have the following by definition of f, meaning that the sum of the alpha tilde is less than 1. Now, s here is defined as a pattern, a rescaled pattern in 0,1 if you want, so that this subscript can also be stated as I in k. And overall, what we get is the following inequality stated over patterns. And that is exactly the main constraint of the dual. And since the alpha tilde values are positive and they satisfy the main constraint, well, we have a dual feasible solution for D. Therefore, the word dual comes from the history of dual feasible function, because they have been discovered or designed in the context of bin packing. And dual is a trace of this history. Okay, let's see now why this concept is useful for integer programming in general. And to do that, we can consider a very general knapsack constraint where ai and b are strictly positive numbers and yi is an integer variable. So a very general constraint like this one. Okay, since b is strictly positive, what we can do is we can divide both sides by b and get the following. Now, this product can also be written as a sum because yi is integer. And if we have a dual feasible function f, then we can apply it. This is the premise of the key property for f. So that if f is dual feasible, then we also have this inequality by definition. And this sum can be stated again as a product, and we get the following. So, starting from any very general knapsack constraint, and assuming we have a dual feasible function f, we'll get this inequality. And the chain of reasonings here definitely shows that this is a valid inequality. And so it's a very general concept to generate valid inequalities from any knapsack constraints. Okay, this is it. This is the second board of our video. And you have a synthesis here starting from the Gilmore and Gomori model, its dual, and how this led to the concept of dual feasible functions, which in turn gave us valid inequalities for very general knapsack constraints. Make sure you see that this goes really beyond just lower bounds for bin packing. So we started from the dual feasible function of Martello and Tott, but there are many others in the literature. I also mentioned three historical papers about this topic, in particular the paper of Martello and Tott, but also Gilmore and Gomori. Finally, you have the survey of Clocio, Alves, Carvalho, if you want to know more. I wish you a good class and a good day.